Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
Okay, today I have more visual kind of eye candies for you, and not only the eye candies, they're really powerful to help you process your scientific data. So we can start with something called PivotViewer, and followed by some demos, and then we will also have some short presentations later of the day. It's gonna be a different dynamics, so I hope you will like it. So here's to start today's presentation is Jason Shaver.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
No applause or anything? Someone walked up to the front. Yeah. Thank you. Now I feel much better. So my name is Jason R. Shaver. I am one of the program managers with the Silverlight team, now part of the Windows Phone team as well. I'm here to talk about the PivotViewer. Over the past 10 years or so, in the media, the public eye, you started to see more infographics. Infographics are kind of this unique form of replacement of the bar chart. The idea is to take information that is relevant to the person you're communicating to and make that data very obvious in a way that they'll remember it. Funny pictures, interesting ideas. So I have a few examples here. Twitter. The data on here is not really what's important. The idea is that they're presenting a set of information branded with their company. They have the bird, they have a branch to go off the Twitter bird on a branch idea. They're presenting information in a way that kind of speaks to their company and to their audience. They're communicating a message here. And not all the messages that they're trying to communicate are business-minded. You could just as easily try to communicate your resume in a very visual sense. This is somebody's random resume off the internet where they're using infographics to explain themselves, their work history. The top graph is their where they worked. You can see the sign shop on the top. In the daily intake and output, you'll see at 8 a.m. he does nothing. By about 2 a.m. in the morning, he gets really funny, he says. So, infographics are a very entertaining and effective way to communicate something to your customer, they do have some problems. They're very fixed in time. An infographic is truth, if you will, as it existed at one moment in time, at the moment where they created that graphic and published it. As knowledge changes, as they get more information, as our gentleman just got a new job, that infographic stays the way it was. It doesn't represent that new information. It also only presents the information that they want to show you. So I'll go back here, and it talks in here about how he gets funny at 2 a.m. It doesn't talk anything about how he also has narcolepsy and sometimes sleeps in the middle of the day. This provides a set of information that he wants the customer to see. And sitting in front of that information you're given, you're missing part of the picture. That information is focused on them as they want you to see it. So the LiveLab teams and the Silverlight team at Microsoft made PivotViewer. The idea with PivotViewer is that all of your data is live, up to the date. The person consuming your information is able to directly navigate and browse that information as they see fit, as they want to find insights for themselves. We provide a very dynamic way of looking at the data. Sometimes data presented in I'll use a simple example, a bar chart, provides a different sense of what that data means than viewing that same set of data in a pie chart. And then keeping that data live with the newest up-to-the-minute sense of items of information that you have. So kind of the mission statement, if you will, of PivotViewer was active exploration instead of passive consumption. What does this mean? We believe the whole of data is greater than the sum of its parts. We believe that when you take a collection of data, the information inherent in the collection is more than just the sum of each item in that collection. Using a nice visual display and being able to navigate that visual display naturally uses a part of our brain that has been given to us, however it happened, for pattern recognition. We see things that are sometimes hard to model right off the bat. We can see these relationships, when shown to us, between item A and item B, but not item C. PivotViewer is our way of helping that happen naturally. So when we build PivotViewer, there are two scenarios that we wanted to focus on, two ways in which we wanted people to have a interaction with their data. One is navigate and act. This is a customer or a business user. He needs to answer a question. He needs to go through his data and find out how to solve a problem. Where can I save the most money on this product line? Which customer should I target for this marketing campaign? Where should I raise the prices of my products to increase overall profits? In a little more environmental sense, where can we put the most of our efforts towards water conservation? The other scenario we wanted to focus on was explore and inspire. Not everything is just about answering a question. I want to assume that a lot of people in this room have an intrinsic like of data. They might love data. When they get data, they look at it, they move it around, they open it in Excel, they start creating tables. They're used to exploring that data. We want to find a way to make that possible without having to have academia level knowledge of influencing data, massaging data, moving it around. We wanted that natural curiosity that people have, students and professionals, to come forward and allow them to find new bits of information. So I'm going to go through a quick demo here. So this, you might be familiar with the data set. This is the periodic table of elements. What I'm going to do here is I'm going to change the sort. And you see up at the top here, and all the visuals of this, I'll be talking through some of the visuals as I go on, but I just want to mention all the visuals of this are customizable for what you're trying to achieve. In my case, I just want to show I have every element colored by its category. So noble gases are a tealish color, alkali metals are red, halogens are yellow. Now, as we talk about exploring data, you actually might want to think about going through and looking at things like sorting on atomic number. You get nice fluid data transforms. But eventually, you start getting through, and you start seeing things like discovery year, sorting by discovery year. And you notice that the 1800s, lots of elemental discovery, as I'm sure we can all understand. And there's a decent amount in the 1900s. And all of a sudden, you start to notice that there's a specific peak in this data. In the 1940s, we reached a renewed enthusiasm for discovering new elements. Some people might guess by them all being actinides, or most all being actinides, that the enthusiasm came from the Manhattan Project and World War II. So some people might remember PU, but AM, CM. With PivotViewer, one of the things you could do is provide different contexts to your data with the amount of data you see on the screen. So right now, I could put in their atomic weight, I could put in their full name, but you won't be able to see it. There's too much data here. So as we zoom in a little bit, you can actually see the data start to pop in. It starts to fill in more and more information. And these are steps that you can control as you explore your data sets of what information shows up. You can zoom in to crazy amounts from 5,000, 10,000 items down to just one. As I zoom into, let's say, plutonium a little bit more, you see that on the right here pops up a list of more information. Electron configuration, density, melting point, boiling point, more information on each item in this list. So let's try to think of another interesting question that we might have. Looking at the boiling point, you might go, what elements are naturally, in their natural state, a gas? And with PivotViewer, that's actually an easy question to solve. We can go to boiling point, take a little slider here on the left and just drag it all the way down to something approaching room temperature. 41, let's say. And now we can see every element that is a gas at its natural state. So to kind of recap that part of it, things you could do with pivot data that are important to understanding your data and navigating through your data. We allow you to sort through any property you can define. We have two natural views of showing your data, one where it's just a collection, a grid, if you will, and one where it's arrayed in a more of a bar sense, which we call the graph view. We allow you to filter, and not just simple less than this, more than this filtering. We could do things like custom date ranges. We can even allow you to create your own sense of what filtering means. As in, you could say filter by electron layout and have your own filter that defines, let's say, visual rings that you could select. And then as you zoom in, you're getting more and more detail on that item. As you zoom out, you're getting more and more context as where that item fits in the big picture. It's not just the idea of having small and large. We can have small, medium, large, extra detailed, super extra duper detailed, detailed to a quarter of a single element. So let me show you a little bit more what this looks like with a little bit more detail. And you can tell I'm running live code here because I'm actually going to go to Visual Studio when I pull it up. So what I have here is a subset of the USDA National Nutrient Database. This is a set of data that we pulled via OData. We pulled it into PivotViewer. The amount of code to make this data visible to you like this is less than one visual page of code. So you don't need to be a computer programmer. You don't need to be a professional. Anyone could go on the internet and figure out how to get data from an OData source and put it into a PivotViewer and be able to see something that immediately looks somewhat close to this. You do have to define visuals. I'll get a little bit later on how we define visuals. But let's talk about the categories here. So in here, you'll notice that I have one major color theme. The dairy in blue, fruits in red, vegetables in green. And what I want to do here is take a look at, let's say, proteins. And just click on proteins, and it refocuses the entire visual to proteins. And you can see that, you know, in the list of proteins, we have beef, pork, lamb, chicken. And let's go on the idea of navigating and acting. Let's say I'm a Seattle resident, and I might be a little health conscious, and I want to find a specific food item to make a meal around. So because of my diet, I want to focus on, let's say, saturated fat, less than 2.1 grams. So we take go saturated fat, take the slider down. And all of a sudden, you see all the items that are greater than 2.1 grams of saturated fat, they fly away. All the items that are within what I want, they collapse into one set. So let's go a little further. That's still too much to pick from, a little too much to sort through. So let's say sugar. I don't want that much sugar in my diet. I'm a little overweight already, so 2.8 grams. Again, more things fly out. Everything that remains collapses in. So now, okay, these are all, you know, reasonably healthy, I'm going to assume, but my doctor said I need more vitamin D, so let's look at what gives me a little bit more vitamin D. So I'm going to say over 2 of vitamin D, and now we're left down to a reasonable, visible, small set. Notice that you can actually see the names of what they are now. I'm going to group this by food group. And you notice that there's only two things that give me a meal in the with the nutrition information that I want, and that's fish and mushrooms. Yeah, I know, it's a really great sample set, right? So what you'll notice here is that you can tell that they're fish and mushrooms. Well, you can tell there are proteins in mushrooms by the purplish color and the green color. Then you also notice that there's a little reddish tint in this box that's labeled calories, and a really red tint in this one. Let's kind of focus in on this. So what you'll see here is we've replicated the visuals for the nutrient information that you see on the side of all the products for every item in this list. So you'll see absolutely great in your vitamins, you know, great in a lot of the things that the country says are good for you, horrible in sodium, 7 grams of sodium, 480-some percent, 200, almost 300 grams of sodium, also not good, almost 500 grams of sodium, not good, and then calories, 290 per ounce. So in a normal meal, this might be 800 calories worth of cod. Small amount of cod, doesn't sound that appetizing, throw in a lot of calories, definitely don't want to eat it. So what we do is we've actually colored the boxes here by calorie content, per ounce or per unit of measure, the amount of calorie density it has. So let's look at some things that, let's say, might not have as much sodium. Because the idea here is you look at this and we come down to cod and we go, well, that's not like anything else in this list. Everything else is pretty low calories. That one's high calories, it's high in sodium. What else is high in sodium? It's all about letting curiosity drive your exploration. So let's talk sodium. So there are many items with low sodium, a few items with higher sodium, one item with crazy sodium, mainly cod. We're going to kind of focus in on this group. And if we look at this set of data, you know something very unique about vegetables. There are two groupings of vegetables in this data. You just look at it and you can see it. We have one set of vegetables with all the other items that are really low in sodium, and the vegetables are the green ones. And then as you go up a little bit in sodium, all of a sudden you don't see very many vegetables, very few even. You go up a little bit more, boom, crazy amount of vegetables. Some of you might want to say, well, why? Why is that? What's the case? What's going on here? What is the data telling us about this? So let's focus in on vegetables here. And you definitely see two distinct peaks. So as we look at this peak, we'll just start looking at what's in here. There are things that don't really seem that weird. Squash, peas, beans, lentils, cow peas, squash, onions, potatoes. As we get a little closer, though, you see lentils, mature seeds, cooked, boiled, with salt. Cowpeas, with salt. Yard-long beans, with salt. Asparagus, with salt. This entire peak are items that are vegetables prepared with salt. You'll also notice, if we go through them a little one more time here, 237 sodium, 238 sodium, 238 sodium, 239 sodium. You could take a wild guess how much salt is used to prepare 1 ounce of, or 1 cup of cowpeas, or pretty much any vegetable on this list. It's basically about 230-some milligrams of sodium. So let's go through here and look back out on this. You'll also notice that there's another distinction in this set of data. They're all green, but there's some that are almost no calorie or low calorie, and there's some that are high calorie. And you notice there's not that many, again, that are in between. So let's kind of review this data by calorie. Again, just exploring through data, looking, noticing something weird, and seeing if there's any truth behind what you're noticing. So in this case, you notice that most vegetables, low in calorie. And then there's this, you know, a few things that are a little higher, and then there's this gap. And you get things that are crazy high. So let's kind of zoom in on this and see what they are. Peanuts, 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 peanut butter, peanuts, peanut butter, peanuts, peanut butter. So if you're going to look at a vegetable, and apparently a peanut is a vegetable, very high in calories. But they're all pretty much the same here. I mean, they're all high in calories, and you know, reasonably, as you look through them, they're all going to be pretty close to the same. So now we might want to see, is there anything else different in peanuts? Is there anything, any separation between the different peanuts? So we could just go through the highlight, and notice it says calories here. that says that calories should be highlighted in red. So let's go instead and say fat. And it does a quick little re-render. And it's all still very high in fat. Okay, not that useful. Calcium. And all about the same in calcium. So let's try one more. Next on the list, vitamin A. And you'll notice there are two peanuts, peanut butters, specifically that are high in vitamin A, and it's the only peanut product. And again, you might go, why? And then my data runs away from me. So as we zoom in on one of these peanuts with the high vitamin A, you'll notice that they are vitamin and mineral fortified, both of them. They're high in vitamin A because they directly inject vitamin A into it. So this is just one set of data and kind of, and obviously a stage presentation. But to find this information, all I did was take this, set the data up into Visual Studio, into PivotViewer, make some visuals, and then think, I have to give a presentation. I have to explain to 40, 50 people how PivotViewer is awesome. So what do I show them? And I could have gone online and tried to find something about vegetables or some things about proteins and find out how it relates to the data. But instead, all I did was I went through and just started clicking all the buttons, navigating through, seeing what shows up where, and go, wow, that's kind of cool. Write it down on my paper. I'm going to talk about that in this presentation. Everything you see is something that we've actually gone through and just found naturally, just found through exploring the data. To get the data in, and let's talk, and I'm going to use OData as an example here. When you have an OData source, there's a bunch of fun ones to play with, scientific ones and business-oriented ones. All you got to do in Silverlight, and I'll put up my email at the end, and if anyone's curious, I can email some sample code for this set of data. But all you do is you tell the PivotViewer where to download the data set from. And that's it. It starts up and downloads it. You go through, you got to define how visuals look, and usually make a few iterations of, well, I need the name of the vegetable or name of the nutrient. I need the details of it. You know, I wanted to show calorie content. When I'm zoomed in enough, I want to show different stuff. You got to go through and you make that stuff. That's an iterative process. That's something where you start at one spot, and you look at it and you go, wow, if I had this one bit more information, I could answer more questions for myself. And so you add that bit of information into your visualization, and you keep going. You just keep doing that until you get something like what I have, where it actually looks pretty informative. Yes. So I'll take a moment. I don't actually have a slide. Do I have a slide for it? I don't have a slide for it. I'll take a second to talk about changes from PivotViewer in Silverlight 4, the changes in PivotViewer in Silverlight 5. And I know this is a very specific kind of subject matter, but for people who might have been exposed to Silverlight before 4 months ago, to people who just are learning about it right now, a major shift kind of happened. Originally, PivotViewer had the CSXML data set, and it was a set of data that you pre-compiled for your PivotViewer with images kind of baked into this file format. And you had to prep all this, give it to your PivotViewer, and it just was a display on that. But that was it. You couldn't change it. You couldn't interact with it that much. So in Silverlight 5, in December 20th last year, we changed PivotViewer to use any collection of data that Silverlight can understand. So you have a list of objects from SQL Server. PivotViewer just gets it, just understands it. You have a list of objects from OData. PivotViewer just understands it. Mm-hmm. We call them trade cards. Yes. Correct. you literally define a, let's say, a box, and you would say, in this spot, put the name of the product here. In this spot, put the picture of it here. In this spot, put the calories, or whatever information I show. And so you actually see when I change something like that would just change the render of the card themselves, the cards turn fuzzy for a second, and that's them rendering from lowest detail into most detail. That fuzziness is the client framework completely re-rendering. Yes. Once you get beyond 5 to 10,000, depending on the client performance, it starts to become more visually sluggish. There are a lot of things you can do to filter data up front of it, or view data in aggregate, and then as you reach a certain zoom level, automatically change your data set to remove the aggregates and go to individual items from an aggregate. You can send me an email and I could walk you through ways of doing that. Not a beginner item, but it's not that hard. Gentleman in the blue? So what happens is when Silverlight downloads your set of data from SQL Server, it's coming across as basically an XML object. They will have the context of the native type of the object, which for geometry, I believe is just binary. And then it carries the context of that of what it could be represented as, geography. When PivotViewer sees that, you can tell it what those terms mean for it. So you can actually, and there are some you could download on the internet already, of viewing geographic data, like a map, in the PivotViewer trade card. I believe that that will be talked about in a presentation in a little bit, like an actual demo of it. Okay.
The question is that when you have those different categories, where do you predefine those categories? Where are you going to pull in those information out? For example, from the table, you could just take maybe the field's names, but how about if just the XML files, or is that something that we can automatically pick, for example, based on the frequency of words appearing in the paper?
Okay, so I'll start the first part of that question. Trying to see if what I'm waiting for is easy here. No. So the first part of the question, data formats. What data forms can I put into here, and what can I do for odd data formats, unstructured document, how do I put it in here? So any data format that can be represented via XML can pretty easily be represented in Silverlight and put into PivotViewer, almost naturally. For things like unstructured data, you do have to do some work to convert that to some form of structured data for PivotViewer to understand. It does rely on the data having some sense of structure that can be translated to objects in Silverlight. So the second part of how do you identify, and from what I understand you're saying, is how do I identify like food groups versus description versus preparation, and then how do I identify what to highlight on or what to sort by? And the real answer, and I'm just trying to see if I can find it really quick in my demo here, so give me one.
These attributes come with the data sets. So it's come from the users. You have to define those attributes. PivotViewer does not define those categories for you. You have to fit in those. It's your own taxonomy, it's your own catalog, your own vocabulary that's viewed in a way that's fashioned this way. So you have to put your own work to define the data with the attributes you want to present.
Yeah, it's pretty much anything you can define and you can provide a metric for. You can toss that information to PivotViewer and it can extract that out of your data. But you have to do the work to define what those things are. Hold on 1 second.
Oh, go ahead.
In a longer sense than today? Okay, so Silverlight 5 was released December 20th, about 4 months, 5 months ago. When we released 5, we changed the license for the Silverlight product. I believe previously it was 2 years between, if you download Silverlight 4, we guaranteed to support that for 2 years. With Silverlight 5, when we released it, we actually changed that license, and we said, we're going to support it for 10 years. Now, we did that for a very specific reason. In Microsoft, as a whole, we are doubling down on XAML technologies. And XAML, for those who aren't familiar, is the visual markup language that's used to render these graphics. XAML is the innate programming language now of a slew of Microsoft products. Windows Phone, Windows 8. This is a Windows 8 laptop, for example. You notice that there's some similarities in visualization between this and PivotViewer because they're both using XAML. So when they doubled down on XAML, they said, what we're going to do is we're going to try to align a bunch of our technologies into one place on XAML. But we can't keep moving that target. We can't keep saying what XAML is today is changing versus what is tomorrow, changing versus what is the next week, when you have 5-6 products all trying to use the same thing and have it be somewhat the same. It's great to say everything's HTML5 when they're all different versions of HTML5. So with Silverlight, they basically extended out the support license for a long time so they have time to catch the rest of the company up. What's going to happen in the future is XAML is going to progress. The Silverlight product, I'm sure, will have more releases. They might not be as big as Silverlight 5. I'm making no announcement of that. I know there's a lot of people who have been curious about that. But there will be releases of Silverlight. XAML will be used everywhere moving forward, all over the place. Oh, sorry.
Sure.
In a very simple Silverlight application, essentially you have a Silverlight control, which may be a graph control. You can define some property in the XAML. You can do some work in the code behind. Mm-hmm. You also bind the Silverlight control to an observable collection that's in the code. The observation collection is filled from whatever data source you want, and you can use a variety of mechanisms to fill the observable collections. So when things change in the observable collections, automatically refreshes the UIs because of the bindings. So, and on the other hand, XAML tends to be static as you define it, so you can do a lot of things in code behind. So you can, whatever you can do in XAML, you can do in code behind, but you can be very dynamic. So you could redo all your categories if you want in 5 minutes, and it could look like completely different. So when you said that the pivot viewer control, it can connect to SQL Server, I presume you meant that you really have an observable collection that you can fill whichever way you want, either OData or ADO.NET library or your choices of doing that.
Yes, that's exactly what I mean.
And then do a lot of things in code behind, apart from what we had defined in XAML. So I was trying to figure out if PivotViewer was in some sense different from the other Silverlight controls that I've seen, or are just a powerful control that fits in the Silverlight controls?
No, it acts the same way as Listbox or any other collection control in Silverlight. You can connect the data by setting a static resource to a data loader object and do it all in XAML if you want. But it's the same as any other Silverlight content control.
The question I had, are you planning on building any sort of templates such as Water ML or any ontologies by particular subject areas?
That is a good question. I have no idea. I personally don't have any plans. I can say that.
So I plan to collaborate with who's interested in doing this. This is one of the reasons we're here, okay? So this is a nice framework. Speaking of data source, it works with everything that Jason mentioned. Also, the demos that I have showed you before, like the sticker, stock sticker, pulls it directly from web service online. So there's a lot of flexibilities with this software, but it's up to you to implement templates for your own community. We love to collaborate with you and then extend that. So I think we'll have a couple more demos by our collaborators, which may answer some of your questions. Let's move on, and then Jason is going to stick around a little bit.
Yes, I will stick around.
And then get best about him offline. So our next presenter is Doc. Are you ready?
So I make notes. My email address is on here at the bottom. If you don't get a chance to catch me, please feel free to send me an email. I respond to all emails within 2 or 3 days. Okay. Yep.
How's that? All right. I won't be very long. My name is Doug. I work for the Consortium for Ocean Leadership with the Integrated Ocean Drilling Program. And I was teasing Jason a little bit earlier that it's never good to follow someone who actually knows what they're talking about on a subject. So I just want to talk real briefly. We are looking at new ways of exposing some of the data that we have in our drilling environments. And one of the things that we ran across with PivotViewer, and we really liked it as a way to visually show some of our information. So I'm going to get out of these slides as soon as I can. But our data actually is being stored inside an RDF triple store. So we're using Virtuoso. So for those of you familiar with that, that's where our data is. But one of the reasons I just wanted to show it was because it shows the flexibility of being able to move data into PivotViewer. So I really liked that as an example of, well, you can have a broad area of collection and move it into this environment. And this is the particular Sparkle call that we use then to retrieve it. But the only thing that's of interest is that all these are going to become facets in our environment. The other thing is that we were using an older version when I was first working on this. So I actually still am working with the CXML and the Deep Zoom and things like that. So a lot of these things are now in Silverlight 5. I'm really kind of excited about, because I think it's going to make it much easier to create these types of environments. One of the things that we really like about PivotViewer, and I'll show it here in a minute, but is that it's a very visual type of environment for exploring this type of data. So let me see if I can switch over here real quick. And pull up the browser here somewhere. There we go. Whoop, I went by it. So this is our data. This is taxonomy data. We're interested in using it for two different types of data. Taxonomy, which is these microfossils, looking at the different structures that exist inside here, and also for drilling disturbance data. Our interest is because this is actually a quite visual type of environment for the scientists. These are biostrat people who are actually looking at microfossils as they're coming up onto the core deck during drilling operations. And they're using that to determine a particular age. And one of the things that's really nice about this is because it is a highly visual environment, we can start to look and sort the information based upon coiling axis, chamber arrangements, things like this. So people can look at the different types of environments that they're in. They can zoom in if they see a particular one. As Jason was showing, we can really kind of provide this quick mechanism for people to take what they're observing in the core lab and get their physical properties down, and then start to drill down until they can visually identify a particular taxa. These are the holotype taxa, so they're like the canonical images that are there. One of the things, though, that's really interesting about this is that if you look at this, again, it provides, as Jason was mentioning, a very visual type of environment to look at these things. So it has a very strong use in the education and outreach environment as well. And one of the things that you can have and do with this that's really fun is that this is what we call the FAD stage, first occurrence of this particular fossil. And here we're looking at geologic time along the bottom. Again, one of the nice things is that you can begin to really see things that are fun and interesting from an educational point in this. So for example, if I look at last occurrence of these, I see a huge spike. For those geologists, they see that this is during the Maastrichtian, right? And this means that we're coming up on a very famous event, right? We're coming up on the KT boundary, a mass extinction event. And so we're actually seeing a spike in this event here where all these poor little critters went away. And what's interesting, though, is that you can actually, and I won't do it, but you can actually start to explore what animals made it through. Which ones of these taxa made it through this event? And what were the physical properties of those particular taxa that made it through this event? So this is a really quick example of some of the things that we can do with PivotViewer. We kind of did this using kind of the more older SL4 type approaches. And I could show you some of these other things in here, but Jason's already done an excellent job with that. For us, I think the interesting thing will be to put more information into this environment, drilling disturbance data, other things like that. It has dual purposes for us, both scientific as well as educational and outreach type environments. And you know, really, I think that's all I have to say. If I can take any questions upon our approach or anything like that or some of the experiences that we had with it. But one of the things I'll mention, since I have a captive audience, is yesterday I was quite interested in the discovery elements of the data, well, in the mashups. Mm-hmm. And I apologize. What was the name of this data explorer? Thank you. And so I was kind of intrigued. It's kind of like I look at this and I go, data explorer. Is there a mechanism by which I can pull data in, mash it up, and then generate, a result from this coming out? And the other thing that's nice is that generating these deep zoom images was somewhat a labor of love, right, mm-hmm. In this type of environment. So moving to this trading card type thing would be much easier to do and let the tiling or the fasting elements take place a lot easier. So, yeah. Oh, at the maximum, these are probably about 1,000 by 2,000 pixels on average, So, part of the difficulty was, and maybe it's a nice example here. This data came out of an RDF triple store. Now that RDF triple store had a pipeline for creating Pivot Viewer, and part of that is because there is a natural connection in faceted interfaces to graph-based environments, and so it's a really nice connection there. I think it was just part of trying to figure out that transform into that. But there were some tools, too, that exist, both open source, and then there's some really nice tools. The Excel tool is really nice for doing that. So you can actually, from an Excel table, and this is what I'm doing actually for the drilling.
There's an add-in to Excel to form the table.
And this was really nice. I'm doing this for the drilling disturbance. I have a collection of images that are drilling disturbances. And drilling disturbances are just as we're moving down through the core, something bad happens, right? Core shatters, something goes wrong, there's compression, something. And these are very important because they alter the depth that we're looking at and change the age ranges and things like that in it. And in the Excel plugin, which is really, from my point of view, and Jason, you made me comment on this, but is an excellent way to start playing with this, right? Because you can take a folder of images, mass import them into this thing, load out your metadata columns inside it, and just generate out the pivot viewer. Now, I think it probably still generates out the CXML and the deep zoom structures right now. I don't know if they're going to move that to the XAML format or not. Okay, so but that's a wonderful way if you look for the Excel plugin. And then there's a set of command line tools too that are available.
There are. So we can, there is a whole set of documentation on this and then examples at different levels. Apparently you can use Excel, do no coding at all, or you can do as savvy as Jason and do a lot of, not like one page worth of view of coding, and then you can have beautiful views at different levels. What it does to you is that it allows you to iterate through your definitions of metadata and attributes. By exploring the data, all of a sudden you realize some of the attributes doesn't really do much. You can remove it from your vocabulary, perhaps, or not use it, but maybe add more details or granularities of the attributes that you wanted to explore. So it's a, by doing a presentation like that, it's a learning experience itself.
Well, these are all holotype fossils, right? So these are ones that are they're the exemplars for that particular one. What the purpose for this is for the scientists is to get them as close as possible. Now, if they come up with a fossil that doesn't match any of these, they're going to be thrilled. Okay, so that's good news if they can find that. But really, what they're doing is they're looking at physical properties of the taxa that they're after, right? And then they're using the facets here to move down through these physical properties, and then matching up against the images. And this is a type of science that really is that scientist's opinion is going right into the database as vetted material, right? So it's cool science in that regard. It's not a, not that I'm downplaying instruments, right? But it's not an instrument taking a reading or anything. Mm-hmm. You're enthusiastic.
It sounds
great. Mm-hmm. Right, they just nail it. And it is fun, again, not only from a scientist point of view, but from an educational point of view, right? Because you can do things like the last occurrence, first occurrence things here was really neat because it really just does show you, here's a KT boundary event. You see the extinction occurring.
Let's take one more question and then move on. Okay.
I used this agent Xuyen gives me last year. I learned the earth science, and I found even though you get the massive data, but it's a small part of the ecosystem. So I feel this tool is just give you some hint or just give you some idea, because we always use the data to do some statistical analysis and to find some real law or prove some principle. So I think how to integrate this tool to the traditional statistic tool and I think that will be very well than just wheel the data.
Yeah. Some integration with BIM maps and this PivotView for the geographic data. Yeah, yeah.
And maybe Jason can answer this.
Right.
Are there other ways to add in other either visualizations or other is it a set number of kind of visual data?
Next talk will help
you.
Okay.
Yes. Steve, are you ready? Thank you so much, Dad.
Yeah.
So we did this kind of presentation, similar presentations in Stockholm in December at the eScience 2011. And then immediately I got a lot of responses and requests saying that for geographic-based research, they really wanted to see simultaneously two views, the map, you know, data changes in the map, and then something like a pivot viewer. Can we put these together? So. We spent a couple of days there coding, and actually in Stockholm, and Steve actually continued and went one step ahead, and then really made although it's preliminary, but it's gonna be really nice to just to give you an idea how you can integrate PivotViewer with other applications.
Okay. Wait, it's good. Oh. Hi everyone. My name is Steve, and I'm presenting with my PhD student, PhD candidate now. Eh? Just passed the candidacy. Alec, he will be looking for a job in 1.5 years. Okay. What I'm talking about today is a sensor web pivot viewer, and then it's an exploratory sensor web browser. We integrate the sensor OGC sensor web standard with Bing Map and with PivotViewer. Hopefully you'll find it's useful. And then let's dive into the presentation. So give you some background. So first background, so we have a vision to build a worldwide sensor web. So we have a lot of sensors out there. And then hopefully you can build something like called sensor web browser, right? We have a general purpose browser. It's not a silo. So we have something we can search to find what's available out there. So the browser go there, okay, so show me these sensors in this area of interest, okay, within this time period. So with a monitoring system, air, water, and smartphones, they can be in the same server, can be a different server, and then, okay, so we have this. So I get the data from first server and into my browser, get data from a second server from the other browser, and third the data from the third browser, third server. And then put them together. It's like a mashup, general purpose mashup. And this is our dream, okay? And how to enable that? Use a lot of standards. And then the challenge is how to hide all the standards, okay? So we don't feel they are standards. Okay, so I call it a dark sensor or dark data problem. And then, for example, the government, right, they see their data, say, this is my precious, right? And then they identify themselves as, I am a data provider. And they don't want to share with others. Anyways, and a lot of scientists also do the same, right? This is my precious, my 30 years of data. I don't want to share. But I sometimes go conference and show up my data. And they hide the precious, they don't share the precious, but precious might be able to help others save the world. But right now we have open data movement, right? So actually we found, even if they want to share, we want to share, and there's no easy way, okay? And then this is our mission, to realize in such sensor web. So basically there are four components we're focusing on. The first one, collect, share, so how to help scientists to share the data easily, and how to help them discover, okay, what data others also have and I can use. And the fourth one is browse, and by using standard to glue them together, including OData, the OGC Open Geospatial Consortium standard, ISO standards like observation and measurement, it's become ISO standard now. So all the standards to glue them together, okay? And also we try to hide the standards. So before we dive into a demo, and I want to introduce the term. So first one is browse. So browse is different from, it's a show the definition. Okay. To browse, to casually look through something in order to find items of interest and gain impression of the content without any prior knowledge of what one is looking for. So you can just browse. Okay, what's over there? Browse. A lot of sensor web portal right now, or the portal published sensors, they are silos, ad hoc, don't allow you to browse what's available out there. And we believe browse is very important. So we define sensor web browser is a computer program with a graphical user interface to display sensor data and use information, and you can navigate the sensor web. So I'll show a demo. I'll quickly show you the first demo, which is without the PivotViewer. And then Alec will take over and show you the other one. It's always interesting to show live demo. And okay, so you can log in with other functions, but basically it's browse. So basically it's connecting to multiple OGC sensor web servers. So we have a search engine with a crawler. That's the other story. For example, I search for this one. I found a sensor. I add a layer, and then I zoom to the layer and can click on it. And click on it, I get the data back. Oh, no data. Try again later. Okay, try the other server. It's embarrassing. And then zoom into the layer and then get the data. Let's try the other one. Let's say water. Okay. Let's find water and get a water sensor. It's an NDBC buoy data set. You get that. You get the sensors. Click on it. Get the data. Something like that. And then it's all based on standards. So everything is standard. So actually it's a lot of XML and web service calls behind the scene. But we try to hide it very well. I can show, can connect to some sensor in Belgium, some servers. For example, this one's in Australia. And we can go there. It's Australia CSIRO. They publish this sensors using the OGC standards. And you can go there. And then basically is I can blind hit because it's standard based. So I can just use the browser, connect to it, and get the data back. And this is one way to browse it, but we have more beautiful way to browse it now.
Thank you, Steve. Can you hear me? Yeah. Okay. So this is our project called Sensor Web PivotViewer. So we create, the first thing I would like to show you is we create a website for this project, and you can search it by Sensor Web PivotViewer, and we have some background introduction and a video and some screen captures of the our prototype. And you can click on it, try it here, and it will link to our prototype. So basically, we have two components. The first one is what we call the Bing Map Sensor Web Browser, and Steve just give you some preview. And the other part is what we call OGC Web Service PivotViewer. So each item here is a data instance in OGC web service. So as Jason said, this is the trade card image. We can show you some information about this data instance. For example, this one is reacted is soil temperature data, and we use at the left hand side we use an image to show what realm of this. Data belongs to. For example, we use a soil image to show this data is related to land and ground. And we use a sea image to show that this data is measure some phenomena related to water. And for example, and the other one is we use sky to show this data is something related to atmosphere. So the beautiful thing about PivotViewer is you can view your collection in a different perspective. For example, we can view as sold by providers, and we can zoom to this one. This provider is the National Data Booing Center. So, and it's very visual, and we put a screen capture here in the trade card, allow user to get some preview about what will happen if you add this data into the Bing map. So as a some after user find this data is what they are interested in, you can just simply click on the add layer button here and click on it. The data will be added into Bing map, and it allow user to browse it. And also Steve mentioned that the PivotViewer is the Bing map is good tool to for user to do the mashup. So we can add multiple layers and multiple data from different data sources. For example, we can find the data in, say, some facet filtering, atmosphere and water, and sort them by providers. And for example, this one is from National Snow and Ice Data Center. And we can zoom in to see the those detailed information and a layer. And as you can see, here is the this data set. And not only the sensor observation service that OGC defined, we can also add the maps that is the web map service. For example, this one is the next rate map. And we can see some also see some preview here. And we can add this to Bing Map as well, and it will show up. So after, it's a nice tool. PivotView is a nice tool for you to discover the data you are interested in, and the Bing Map is allows you to view the data in a very intuitive way. So, and as Steve showed, we can find the sensor we are interested in and click on it, and get some detailed information about the sensor through the OGC standard sensor markup language, and also get some time series through the OGC observation standard protocol. So yeah, and this is our first prototype of this sensor web people viewer.
Questions? Hi, Phil.
Yeah.
How long, eh? Of course. Long. No, actually. No, actually, this, we found pretty good documentation. Actually, it didn't take long. Yeah. But it's mainly an integration of what we have and add the people viewer on top of it. Yeah, so it didn't. But the longest is the these trade cards, these are manually created.
For the moment.
There's yeah. Better ways of doing it. Yeah, for a moment. And then actually we didn't know there's a new one. At least I didn't know. And then so we are, you know, we can move to the new one. This is an old one, right? Old people viewer. Yeah, the new one looks much better. Yeah.
So there's other stories in between. So when Steve got started, we're going to hook him up with developers. And then in between, we changed the speakers. Jason was just filling in the last minute because the other one left Microsoft recently. Another one had a family emergency. So Jason is the third one filled in. But he's also the one that created the original demos for us. You know, so, right. Yay. Thank you. So, there is a lot of potential with this kind of, you know, integrated visualization effect. I'm just grateful that we got you the last minute into the agenda and show this. So I'm looking for feedback and any suggestions, any requests that you want, how you want to use this. And then that will help us actually push forward with developing more features into this PivotViewer software. So we need to hear from you. Let us know offline or email and anything. So we're going to move on because I had this demo the last minute. It wasn't in the original agenda, but it's one of the best, my personal. Yeah.
What stuff you guys have done, are you guys going to make that available for others to be able to utilize?
Yeah, definitely. Okay. Yes, for in many aspects. For example, you want to code, and we can share some codes, and but it's heavily integrated into our platform, so not all the, you know, but because you can integrate into a platform, right, it's a good example. And then also the sensor web OGC server, it's freely available to download. And then we're also doing some old data and OGC integration, and those will open as well. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's our question as well. It'll be great if we can zoom into a trade car and the map also zoom into that location.
Well, or even make selection of the map.
Yeah.
Both of those
should be possible. With the programming ability, the system supports it if you have the programming ability to understand it.
So the bi-directional API.
Yes.
Awesome.
So you, what you're thinking of, Doug, is be able to zoom in on, say, the US, and then limit down the sensors that are just in that view, maybe.
Right, yeah, or even that camera.
Yeah.
So we don't need to
click USA and filter USA. We can just zoom in and show all USA. That would be great.
Oh, and they were saying, oh, okay. If I have Connect, I would just say, go to USA, and then that. Okay, we're going to, thanks again, and three of you, okay? Four of you. Jason, hang around, and then they're going to have a lot of questions for you. Yeah. Okay, great. So we're going to switch gear to a different topic. Wenming is going to talk about HPC and cloud computing. We're going to start with an overview, and after break, and Wenming is going to do more demos.
This is on now? Okay, perfect. Well, good morning, everyone. My name is Wenming Yi. I'm a technical evangelist for Windows Azure. So my primary responsibility is Windows Azure Big Compute and also Big Data. So I used to be the Windows Server HPC evangelist. So some of you have seen my presentation from last year. So today I have two topics for the presentation. One is we'll go over the current status of Windows HPC and how we are taking that framework and making that work on Windows Azure. And the second topic is something that's relatively new for Microsoft, which is running Hadoop on Windows Azure. So Hadoop is an open source MapReduce framework, which people are using to process big data or large amounts of data, and it's a very similar HPC, which is very much batch system. So you're processing large amounts of data in the background in a distributed way. So that's the two topics that I'll cover, and I also have a couple of interesting demos to show. What is our? When do we start the break for these guys? Yeah, when is the break? Oh, I'm sorry, sorry. What? Oh, okay. Until 11? Wow. Oh, okay. Oh, okay, great. Oh, not already. Okay, great. Okay. All right. So it is still my session. So let me get started here. The first thing I want to show you is the Windows Azure toolkit. So my current group is Windows Azure, and what we have now, if I show the desktop here, is a Windows Azure a training kit. So a lot of the HPC content actually goes in there right now. So how many of you actually know what Windows Azure is? Most of you should, right? So by now. So for those of you who don't know what it is, it's Microsoft's cloud solution. In a very basic sentence, is that you're trying to make resources available in a centralized public data center where you can rent them by the hour, essentially. And these machines can be turned on and off at any time. And they have centralized storage system, which means you can turn off your machine and not lose your data that you're working on. So there's centralized storage, and there's things like CDN, which allows you to distribute your data across geological locations. And we have data centers all around the world. So I think they just announced that we added two more new data center this week. I think now we have 8 in the U.S. and a bunch of them in Europe, and I think there's a few in South America. Dan, do you know? There might be. Okay. So this training kit is designed to get you guys started, and it's really designed to, for every aspect of cloud computing. So for the cloud computing workload, there's, web-based workloads for people who are hosting websites, who are building business line of business applications where they have a database backend, and they have certain applications that they run internally. And then there's my favorite type of application, which is HPC. So that accounts for 10-20% of the entire workload. And then there's data intensive type of applications. We have storage to hold all your data. So the training kit consists of all these different aspects of what the cloud is. And we have like 20 or 30 different presentations, and it gives you an overview of what Windows Azure is and what Windows Azure Compute is and storage, if you just want to look at how you store different three different types of storage that we have, which is blob, queues, and tables, and also how do you build devised applications and make them cloud enabled. So being looking at things like notification services and things along that line. We even have training kit that allows you to build Windows and iOS devices and also Android devices, and shows you how to use the cloud through those devices to make them more cloud centric. And also there's different pieces that. That's more of a like a scenario based. So social games, how do you build a social game? We even have a C# social game toolkit for Facebook. So there's a lot of components that enable you to build a global scale application. So cloud computing is really growing very fast. And the next interesting thing is that how do you utilize all these computing resources for scientific computing. So that's what I am going to focus today. But if you want to build any, you're looking for any type of sample code or things that you want to do with your application, the pieces are all in here. There's a tremendous amount of resources, presentations, sample codes that you can utilize in here. We also have hands-on labs, and hands-on labs are something that you can walk through, and it's really very basic. It just gets you started with step-by-step instructions. So that's the training kit. And my samples, which is at the very bottom, so we have our HPC content at the very bottom. So here's my presentation for today, which is how do you build an HPC application in the cloud. So let me get started on that. Oh, by the way, have you any of you guys actually tried to use the training kit before? Oh, one person, two. Okay, awesome. Well, maybe three. But it's really a very interesting way to learn about how you can build applications that are stateless and really designing it for the cloud. Oop. So I understand that this particular conference is all about data, but a lot of you probably do know and use HPC. So how many of you guys actually use HPC on a, I would say, casual basis or... lots of you. So I would say at least half of you do. Also, compute. So how many of you actually have your own cluster? Quite a few. A personal cluster. So I happen to have three of those departmental. I happen to have three of them sitting in the data center right next to us. It's one of those machines that when our HPC marketing team decided that they want to run scientific code themselves, it really never happened. So I inherited three different machines from three different people. So what I've been doing on these machines is, running all the traditional scientific codes like WRF, which is weather research and forecast. A lot of them are engineering codes like OpenFOAM, which is a CFD code, and we can run GraalMax, and a lot of the codes has been kind of ported to Windows Server. So that was Windows HPC. That actually happened between 2005 and 2009, I would say. And what really happened? Is that people really loved it. People found it to be very useful to be able to put a bunch of machines together and cluster them using UI. And most of our ISVs, like including a couple of guys from Cray, found that to be a very interesting scenario, which they could have just even students and go build a cluster. But the difficult problem turns out to be that a lot of these scientific applications run only on Linux. So they don't necessarily port well over to Windows. So this is the work that I've been doing for the last few years. So one of the things I did is to take, help the community build a cross-compiler that is capable of taking just your Linux, simply your Linux code, and just simply go port that over. And that's actually really becoming very convenient. So there's a website which I want you to probably take down. It's called the hpclinux.com. So let me open a new browser, hpclinux.com. So we have a virtual machine that I collaborated with ParaTools. You guys probably have heard of ParaTools. So it's a company which they do a lot of performance analysis on HPC codes. So what's interesting here is that you can go ahead and download a virtual machine that is just a Linux virtual machine. And you can take your code and put it on that machine and say module load, which is a standard standard Cray-based package management system. And you can say module load p2wins. What it will do is we'll actually load up all MSMPI, which is the message passing library that's very much standard. And you can do a compile, config, and build. And in most cases, you'll actually have your Windows binary cross-compiled on the Linux box. And you can take those binaries and move it onto Windows, or later on we'll show you how to do that with Windows Azure, and copy them over and they would just simply run. And the cross-compiler exists for Windows, Linux, Mac, and all the, basically all the major platforms. What it means is that it's compiling your C code or your native code and outputting binary. So there's a bit of a problem here. Where are the libraries? So if you have, let's just say, you need your Windows library. So what you need to do is you can copy them. Traditionally, you have to copy them onto a machine and do the cross-compiling. But with the this particular tool, you would no longer have to do that because we pre-copy MSMPI for you. And you can just simply go build your HPC application like right there. And that would be very much straightforward. So the focus for the HPC team has actually shifted a little bit. So it's part of the Windows Azure team now. So what that means is that we're still going to support the on-premise cluster, which means you will still have the capability of finding all your used desktops and network them, all of them together. So it supports not only Windows Server in the cluster. Let me go back to the slides here. It also supports, okay, there you go. So this is the picture. So it supports Windows 7. You can, once you install the server, you can have Windows Server, Windows HPC Server as the compute node, and also you can have Windows Azure as the node. So what that really is that you buy a license for this, you know, maybe one server. And then that server is capable of managing and controlling Windows 7 machines, Windows Server machines, and you can even add a Windows Azure node as you want. So I'm going to show you a really quick demo of how that works in live. So Cray03. So this is one of the machines that's actually sitting next door. I call it Cray. It's actually really a Cray. So what this machine has is a, I think it's from 2008. So it's got InfiniBand built in, and it's also got a few other interesting things, which is it's a just one box. It's a pizza box. So it's a you just basically slide everything in. So it has a really nice, easy to use management console. So we can go to start, and you can see I have a lot of little applications. So since we only have really half an hour to just talk about HPC today, I'm not going to go and, you know, actually run any applications here. But as you can see that I actually added these Azure nodes by just, you know, simply right-click and say I want to add these nodes, and I want to add Windows Azure nodes. And these nodes are sitting in somewhere in the data center. So how do you enter the credentials? When you actually set this up, you have to enter your storage key for accessing to the storage system, and also your management certificate for the Windows Azure. It's really easy to do. It's simply just uploading these certificates. So if you want to add nodes or, you know, remove nodes, you can simply just go in the console and say, I want to add more nodes from group 1 or group 2 or group 3. So these are different Azure subscriptions that I have. And you can make them medium. So the Azure nodes are essentially generic compute boxes. And for the small instance, you have one core. And these are actually physical machines that currently the largest size is 8 cores. So you can, the extra large is 8 cores and large is 4 cores. And then, you know, basically you're running VMs on top of these machines. So and then you can simply add these nodes and use them as compute nodes. So this is a kind of a convenient way of doing things. But there are always people that wanted to just simply have nothing to do with on-premise based systems. So they just want to have everything running in the cloud. So we have something called a HPC Azure Job Scheduler. So what that means is that there's no more servers. All you have to do is to deploy your entire cluster into Azure. So let me move through all the crazy animation here. Here's the Azure Scheduler. So what that's doing for you is that you have all the HPC functionality set up in Azure. So you have a cluster that you can create. You can dynamically resize them as you want. And it's kind of, you know, really nice if you, once you start using it. But, and I do realize there's a little bit of a barrier for entry, because when the product group designed it, it was designed to only work with Visual Studio. So I said, well, you know, most IT pro people, or people who want to set up a cluster, or people who are coming from a Linux background, or, you know, from other platforms, may not like that. So scripting seems to be the default, or one of the more popular way of deploying things, you know, not just on-premise, but also in the cloud. So what I actually did is I actually took that entire package and used a PowerShell to do the deployment. So you can actually download that package from my blog. If I go to blog, let's see, blog. MSDN, and that will actually be supported by the product team later. So if you go to HPC Tracker MSDN, so it's just HPC TRECKER, and if you go to deploying, how do you do that? You know, how do you do the deployment? It's really quite straightforward. So all you have to do is to download the package at the very end on my Dropbox. So go to all the way, go to the end. So it's right there. So you can just download it from that particular URL, and it will just ask you questions as you deploy it. And you can just simply say, okay, how many nodes do you need, how do you, you know, it's really quite simple. All you're doing is to running through the script, run the script, and then you can add in your subscription ID, which is, you know, very straightforward, and then your keys, and tell it where the Azure SDK is, and, you know, select what management certificates there are, and it's really step-by-step, a walkthrough of how you do that. So once you're done, you essentially have a cluster running in the cloud. So I actually have one running for the last 3 months, and I was thinking that it would die somehow in the middle of it, and so far, I suddenly had this huge boost for cloud confidence because it hasn't died yet. So it's still running. And the application is sitting here called the weather service, the cloudapp.net. So this is something that's relatively, I would say, close to what you guys are working on. It's not quite data, but it's more of a traditional HPC application where you actually have a lot of data, but on the other hand, you are mostly doing CPU-intensive workload. So the first question I know that you guys are going to ask is, well, how do you run this on a cluster when Azure doesn't have InfiniBand? So most of you probably know what InfiniBand is. It's a fast interconnect which has two or three microsecond delay, and in the orders of 100 gigabps bandwidth, which is 100 times by all the different measures better than Ethernet, right? So, well, the answer is you don't. So here what I'm actually doing is I'm running the WRF, the Weather Research Forecast Simulation, on one simulation on each node. And since the largest node that we currently have is 8 cores, so I'm simply running 180 kilometer by 180 kilometer simulation on Windows Azure using one node. And I can, since I can scale it, the only way I'm doing the parallelism is whizzing that particular node using MPI. So it's shared memory MPI run. And if I want to run this on hundreds of cities, it's simply going to the portal and enter the number of nodes that I want, and it will start the cluster. In fact, we're going to try that today, and I'm going to have you guys submit a weather prediction for one of your favorite city to the system, if you're, if you want to. So let me kind of explain how this works first. First of all, this is running through the pipeline of WRF. Which means you get the data from NOAA. NOAA has an FTP server. So this is even more primitive than old data or anything like that. They just provide the data on an FTP server. This is our initial conditions for your simulation. So I FTP that. And the second thing is that I run through some initial conditions and make sure that the simulation is set up. And I run WPS, the preprocessors, and then make sure that I have all the geogrid information and have that on a particular compute node. So since that, one of the most difficult part about cloud computing is that you have to think in terms of stateless. So you cannot assume that machine is going to be there, even a day from now. So it may get rebooted or things may happen. So the biggest thing you have to do is to make sure that you keep your data in the permanent storage, which is the blob storage. And the second thing is that when you start a simulation, you have to make sure that that node has all the software that's required. So I'm using something called a worker role in the back end to do the processing. So when I prepare these nodes, there's something called a startup task. This is where it installs Python, installs all these different tools that I need for post and pre-processing, and installs the HPC bits, meaning the WRF binary executable. So it prepares the nodes. And for each of the jobs, I actually copy the data from the permanent blob storage onto that node and run the processing. So that's essentially how it works. So currently, I have on the system, I have three nodes running. So most of the simulations have finished. So if I want to go start a new simulation, and I can simply go to a Bing map layer and simply drag the star around. So give me a city where you want to run a forecast. Where Maryland? Okay. Baltimore. Okay. So I have to keep moving it. There's Baltimore. Okay. So we're just gonna say. Actually, I can even zoom in a little bit to make sure that it's your favorite building. Oh, oops. Okay, there you go. Yeah, so you can do, zoom in and out. So there's, it's kind of a little off. Let me move it, yeah. Okay. Well, close enough. So we'll just say Baltimore. And create a forecast. And what's interesting here is that I can go back to the home, and simply show you what the pipeline looks like. And look at each of the details. As you can see, these simulations actually run for a long time. So WRF is a real weather forecast code from UNCAR. So that thing could. So for what I'm doing is 180 kilometer by 180 kilometer. And so that ran for about 6 hours or so. So that's a long time. And so you guys might ask me how many of these simulations actually succeeded. I would say 99.9% of all the simulations succeeded, meaning that the Azure hardware we have, at least from what I did, seems to sustain very compute-intensive workloads. So I didn't have any problems with these codes failing or dying in any way. And then there's the pipeline. So the pipeline is really glued together using a PowerShell script. So which means if you have a very complex scientific workflow, and you don't want to use, let's just say, Windows workflow or any of these more complex software, you don't want to learn anything like that, you can simply use a PowerShell script to glue them all together. So some of them are executables. We don't simply ask you to write .NET code. There is no .NET code written here. So this is all pretty much just running, as you can see, running executables. You run the meta grid and you run the geo grid. So I pull in 13 gigabytes of data. That's the geo grid information, and the meta grid. I think I have to get it from NOAA, which is about 500 megabytes or so. So each of these simulations, I pull these data in, and of course the geo information never changes. So you're just pulling that from blob storage. And then there is a scheduling, simply using Windows scheduler tool. Every Windows machine has a scheduler tool. So you just run it every hour, say, do I have any new data set from NOAA? And that worked really well for me. I didn't have to do anything other than just simply using the Windows scheduler. And it's a very simple API. You can simply say scheduler slash whatever, what interval you want. It's simply like a cron job on Unix box. And you can see that the simulation actually runs for a long time, runs for about 6 hours, and you can, that's very compute intensive. You can keep that running. And once that finishes running, we have to do a few different things. One is we run the NCL script, which is the UNCAR graphics language. As you can see, I'm still, within this PowerShell script, right? So run the graphics tool to generate all the tiles for the map, and also, for the animated GIFs that I'm creating. And the second thing that I, after that, I have to run GDAL, which is to make sure that it translates it into the Bing map format. So it's GDAL works for both Google maps and also for Bing maps. And then we run these tiling Python utilities, and this is what you're actually seeing there. So if you kind of think about how many images that I'm creating, it's really in the orders of even many hundreds of images that I'm creating, because I'm animating through five different, So for each of these simulations, look, people are already starting to run. I think some of these are submitted by someone else here. So what if I wanted to go ahead and scale that cluster up so more of you could actually go run a simulation? So it's really, really simple. All I have to do is to go to Windows Azure's portal. One of these is Windows Azure portal. Oh, none of these are. Okay. We just have to go to windowsazure.com. That's easy enough. And I'm going to log in. And intentionally made these font really large so everybody can see. Yes, go ahead. So then you would have to basically change the input file. So there's a nameless file for WRF. So you have to go in and change that. So that's file you can either log in to change that, or we can put up a little file editing box for people. But right now, to prevent people from accidentally, you know, changing something, I have restricted to just simply, you know, click and run. The thing is that a lot of these scientific codes, as soon as you change the parameter, you know, by mistake, they'll just blow up. They won't run. And 8 hours later, you have a bad program. So somehow, I got this down to a point where this thing never fails. So you can run it on just anywhere in the world. You run, you go do a run, and it will just keep on running. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you on Windows Azure what it actually looks like. To actually have this service deployed. So you can see that I have a production service, and that's just me running. Hold on 1 second. There's the weather service, I think. Yeah, I think that's what it is. So as you can see, I have a front end, which is the web role. And I have a head node, which controls the cluster. So the head node is actually only 2 cores, but the rest of them are 8 cores. And then I have a front end, which you can, you know, log in to look up information, and also just serves the web services. So what I like to do is actually to go ahead and resize this a little bit, so I can go to config basically go in and edit this manually and say I want, you know, instead of 3 extra large instances, so we'll just say do 20, and it's going to cost a lot of money, so I'm going to do that anyway, and so there you go. So this is going to take about 15 minutes. So the extra large instance cost, I think it's 96 cents per hour if you just buy it by the hour. If you have like a plan, it becomes much cheaper. So obviously this is not my account. So I'm just starting to run that. So what actually happened is that you can log also terminal service into these machines. So here I'm actually showing you, I'm logged into that Cray box, right? So that's the Cray machine. But if you log onto any of the Azure nodes, it's very much identical to Windows Server. I mean, it is Windows Server essentially running. So what I can do is I can go to the go to this machine and simply say, okay, I want to actually look at what the cluster looked like when I remote terminal service in. The problem is that my window is a little, I can't seem to log in right now, but once you log in, you'll see exactly the same machine when you do log in. So in about 15 minutes, when we come back from the break, we'll essentially be able to submit to a lot more jobs against the cluster. So the interesting thing here is that you can actually use the commodity hardware to do a lot of computing. Just think about how else would you be able to do this. So would you be able to go find 20 machines in the next 15 minutes and put it in here, power them up, have the OS installed, and have everything running? Probably not. So the nice thing about platform as a service is that you essentially create this stateless install where you can deploy this anytime within just a few minutes, and you would be able to do any type of computation rather easily. And I think this the good practice of having everything being stateless will essentially help you to run this on not just simply in the cloud, but also be able to run on your local machine better as well. So it's really making your code more modular and also more portable from one environment into another. So this is something that a lot of people should be doing regardless of how where they're targeting their cloud services. So so I guess we can take a little break for 15 minutes, and we'll come back at the top of the hour. And then we'll talk about, we'll continue this, and also we'll talk about Hadoop on Azure and show you our Hadoop on Azure web portal and how to run some, fairly basic Hadoop, MapReduce applications. All right, thanks.